In this episode, I'll present the materials used in polymer powder bed fusion. In the last video, I already mentioned semicrystalline polymers and what 100% crystalline structure would mean. Polymers are always semicrystalline. They have amorphous and crystalline parts, so they're never 100% crystalline. And therefore, they have a distinct melting and crystallization behavior with a hysteresis between the two. And that's important for our process window. In contrast to that, amorphous thermoplastics have a fairly wide temperature range for softening and are thus used a lot less. Some efforts have been done with polystyrene, and they were used for casting molds. But the typical powder bed fusion materials for in polymers are nylons. The first was nylon 12, and that was the only one for a long time. Then nylon 11, which is more ductile. And then we see more and more other materials. Also, for example, huge efforts are put into nylon 6 and 6,6, which are typical technical thermoplastics used already in the polymer industry, plastics industry. So there's a heightened interest to also create powders that we can use in powder bed fusion. Then PEEK and PAEK, high temperature materials, aerospace applications, very interesting, and TPEs, the thermoplastic elastomers that have more flexibility, elastic recovery, that have just unique behavior compared to other semicrystalline polymers. The characteristics that we have and we need for powder bed fusion is semicrystalline materials or thermoplastics have a higher shrinkage than the amorphous materials, and that results in curling and warpage. So we have to deal with deformation that's happening, and the temperature control understanding is super important for these processes. We need good flowability of the particles. We need spherical particles for that reason, because we need to get a uniform and even coat that we don't have little holes inside of our new layer, and then we would get pores and voids inside of the parts. We want materials with broad processing and sintering windows, so a relatively huge delta T between the melt temperature and crystallization temperature, and we want good absorption characteristics for the laser. Typically, CO2 lasers with a wavelength of 10.6 micrometers are used, because polymers of all kind absorb very well at that wavelength, and it allows us to use one machine for different materials.